Well, before we begin our Bible study, I wanted to mention that we had quite a few people come here yesterday for a work party, kind of to prepare our church for Easter. And, the beginning of spring is a good time to start to throw out some things that are a little bit older and spruce up some stuff that we want to prepare for the coming season. And so it's a great time. It's a great time to do that. And if you haven't yet, I encourage you to go peek through a window and check out the inner courtyard. It's just in the center of our building. And there's a bunch of frame elements that are prepared to have the final roofing material laid on top of all of those to put the shade in for our inner courtyard. It's a really, really awesome picture of just how things are being built, and for those of you who've been around for a little while, you've seen what was there beforehand and how kind of old and decrepit it got. And then we tore that down, and now we're beginning this process of rebuilding something. And I just thought, wow, what a great picture of what God does in our lives. And I was encouraged earlier this week as I was thinking about the whole process we have been through to get those things up. It took planning, it took getting materials, it took people who know how to put the sticks where they're supposed to go. And and then it takes time to do it. It takes time to put it all together. I thought, well, isn't that how it works in God for my life? That even as God is doing like a restorative work, or he's doing a bit of renovation in my heart, it often isn't just boom, and then this new structure is completely constructed in my heart. But that it takes some time, and that's okay. That's okay. In some cases, that's by design. That's how the Lord does it. And so the more that we can sort of let go of what we want to impose on godly processes in our lives, to say, God, I want it to be this way, or it has to be this way, and if we let go and just say, Lord, no, your way, not my way. I think you might even enjoy the renovation process more than just being stressed out about it. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to be here yesterday. Many of you know I have some back problems, and yesterday was just a really bad day for me. And I really agonized over that. I really did, because I wanted to be here. First of all, because it's a lot of fun. If you haven't come to one of our work parties in the last like year or so, I got to tell you, it's a ton of fun. Everyone from the not so young all the way down to the very young, all like together doing things. And what I love about the people who plan and prepare for this is they think about, okay, what could, you know, little kids do with their parents together, so that it's not just the adults doing the adult stuff and then the kids go off and do their thing, but we try to integrate it. And it's great fun to kind of just see all these different people around, and a great chance to connect with someone that maybe you don't have time to connect with on a Sunday morning. So of course I was sad that I was going to miss that. But even more than that, I was just agonizing over the fact that I don't necessarily have a lot of intersection points between my life and your lives. And it makes me uncomfortable that isn't true, because I want to have intersection points. And I really don't want to just have my leadership of this church be on a platform here every Sunday morning. That's not the sum total of what I want it to be. That's not what was patterned for me. It's not what I believe in. It's not what I believe the Bible teaches. And I don't think any of us, regardless of our position, should just only have a belief system or a devotion to God that is only platformed in front of other people. I mean, it's lived out. And perhaps the more important aspect is those quiet times, isn't it, when no one's looking. But I just want to say that I don't know, I want to be with you. And I don't know what's going on with my back, and I hope that the Lord heals me through one avenue or another. Kind of doesn't really matter to me. You know what I'm talking about? Give me a miracle, give me medicine, I don't care. Like, I just want to be well. Like, let's go. But yeah, thank you for bearing with me, for withstanding what is kind of an unusual situation with the senior pastor of a church and the circumstance that we have here. But, you know, the other thing that the Lord has been talking to me a lot about is just the funny tension of having to live within our limitations. And, you know, we could take that to an extreme and talk about how as humans, whether your body is whole, your mind is whole, your emotional state is fine, no matter how whole you are, there are things that we need that we cannot access for ourselves. You know, forgiveness for our sins would be one of them, wouldn't it? But there's a whole host of things beyond just sin in our lives that we need God for. And I've expressed this to you before, but it's not such a bad place to be in a position in your life where you need God. That's really not a bad place. And if we're not careful, all of the prayers, all of the desires, all of the goals of how we are trying to arrange our lives can be to try to avoid needing God in the future. And that's not how I want to position myself. I want to live fully within the limitations of what I am capable of. And what's weird for me now is I'm experiencing like what's the opposite of evolution? Devolution? Unraveling? I don't know. Like, I'm going backwards with my capability, you know what I mean? Like, as far as my time and what my body can handle and stuff like that. And so that's a bit strange, you know, to have my capability feel like it's kind of, you know, going backwards. But that really is a part of life. And whether it's sooner or later, we get older, our time gets constrained, things happen in life, and we're not able to live in this idyllic, picture-perfect life where everything's fine and comfortable and easy and those things that would be great, wouldn't it? But that's just not reality. So I guess what I'm saying is I don't want to toil with having a fantasy be my hope of having everything be easy, have everything be fine. It's not to say that I don't want to be healed. It's not to say that I don't want to be whole. And it's not to say that I don't believe God wants to do those kinds of things in your life. But what I am saying is that heaven is that place where those things will be true. But until then, there is going to be tribulation. That also doesn't mean that we have to live a life where we're so like heavily depressed all the time because life is just a bear sometimes. And some, you know, just, I don't know, recently, I'm just kind of talking here, I don't know, we'll get to the Bible study in a second, but yeah, recently the Lord's been convicting me with how much I slip into complaining about whatever. It's so easy to complain about work, about life and hard and stuff, and, you know, especially when I open the conversation, like, hey, Evan, how you doing? Like, oh, I'm doing okay, my back is hurting, I'm having a hard time, and then it just almost starts this tit for tat with people like, oh yeah, man, well, here's this other horrible thing that's going on. I'm like, yeah, there's another horrible thing that's going on here too. But all of a sudden we're in this kind of dark place. Like, I don't think the light of Jesus is anywhere in this conversation. That's not how I want to live. That's not where I want to be. So those things are true. I'm not living in a fantasy. But at the same time, like, that doesn't mean that I have to be depressed, because there's also joy. There's also the presence of the Lord. Even like in the midst of my enemies, you know, the Lord presents or prepares a table before me in the midst of my enemies. Like that is how extreme God is able to bring his goodness and his joy and his presence in the midst of whatever it is. You know, as we come up on Easter, we remember certain things. They're always true. But we take some time to focus specifically on very specific things. And one of those things is the fact that Jesus Christ has conquered the power of death. The significance of that for everything else in our world is there's no other power, there's no other degradation, there's no other devolution. You with me on that? You want to go with me on that one? I can make up words. There's no other unraveling of our spirit, our soul, our mind, our body, that is greater than death. So we celebrate the fact that Jesus has conquered the mightiest foe that exists. And then what flows out of that is easier access to faith, that the thing that I'm facing right now that might not be the threat of death, I mean, it might be in your life, but it might not be. But whatever it is, Jesus can do something about it. And so what we are invited into is this kind of funny place where even though we have not yet experienced victory in the places where we are struggling and the things that we face, we still can live in that victory, but not pretending like the struggle isn't real and not pretending like the struggle isn't there at all. And sometimes that can be a little bit difficult to know exactly how to do that. And I just want to say to you that it's okay if even in your struggle you are struggling to know how do I live, Lord, within my limitation, but also believing that you can do something about my limitation. So I think of that scripture where Paul says, I've learned the secret of being content with much and with little. And I think specifically he was talking about like physical resource, you know, like I've had a lot and I've had a little. But that certainly can be applied to any number of spiritual resources. And so if the Lord blesses me to have a lot of capability or a lot of time or a lot of insight or whatever, I want to learn how to live being content in those things. At the same time, if I have to live in a smaller place because of whatever limitation, I also want to learn how to live contentedly in that place. Because in the end, honestly, in the end, God is not limited to save, to do his powerful action by many or by few. So that could be people, that could be minutes in your day. He's just not limited by it. So, I don't know, this whole journey for me has forced me to look at, with honest eyes, what I can do. And the Lord is beckoning me, instead of being so introspective and so focused on what I can or cannot do, he is casting my eyes to the heavens, where he is, and casting my mind to remember these are the kinds of things that God does. And so that has a way of just giving me peace about what I can or cannot do, because I believe in the God who can. So all that to say is I missed yesterday, and let's do our Bible study. Oh, man. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Well, yet again, we're coming to a section of scripture that I, with near perfect amnesia, say, oh, this is one of my favorite scriptures. I said that to Lindsay this week. I'm like, oh, we're coming up on one of my favorites. She's like, you say that every week. And I'm like, do I? Really? Well, it's true again. There's a phrase in here that has become a value statement of my life that I'm excited to talk about a little bit. But I'm going to go ahead and read verses 1 through 15 and believe big that we'll get through some meaningful percentage of those verses. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Paul says this, I wish that you would bear with me in a little foolishness, but indeed you are bearing with me. For I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy, for I betrothed you to one husband, that to Christ I might present you as a pure virgin. But I am afraid lest as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, your minds should be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. For if one comes and preaches another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or you receive a different spirit which you have not received, or a different gospel which you have not accepted, you bear this beautifully. For I consider myself not in the least inferior to the most eminent apostles. But even if I am unskilled in speech, yet I am not so in knowledge. In fact, in every way we have made this evident to you in all things. Or did I commit a sin in humbling myself, that you might be exalted, because I preached the gospel of God to you without charge? I robbed other churches, taking wages from them to serve you. And when I was present with you and was in need, I was not a burden to anyone. For when the brethren came from Macedonia, they fully supplied my need, and in everything I kept myself from being a burden to you, and will continue to do so. As the truth of Christ is in me, this boasting of mine will not be stopped in the regions of Achaia. Why? Because I do not love you? God knows I do. But what I am doing, I will continue to do, that I may cut off opportunity from those who desire an opportunity, to be regarded just as we are in the matter about which they are boasting. For such men are false apostles, deceitful workers, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. Therefore, it is not surprising if his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their deeds. Okay. This chapter, of course, is a continuation of the letter that Paul is writing to the Corinthians about how to become truly spiritual and influential people for the kingdom of God, and warning them away from this very shiny and attractive path that cuts a lot of corners, that is ill-advised, that appears to lead to this place of prominence, of preeminence, importance, significance, recognition. And Paul is comparing and contrasting that path with the path that Jesus gave us as an example, one that is the path of a servant, one that goes underneath people to lift them up instead of using whatever authority God has given us to come down on top of people. And so Paul's expressing a lot of concern now here in chapter 11 and finally getting to addressing directly what he calls in one place the most eminent apostles or super apostles, and in another place these false apostles. He's talking about these people who have been leading the Corinthians astray and even slandering the ministry of Paul in the meantime. And so I've been alluding to this all along because I read ahead of our Bible study. It's a wise thing to do. And so I knew that this was coming up, and so I've been talking about these pseudo or fake apostles the whole time, but now is actually the time when Paul addresses them directly. But I want to go back through and go through line by line, because this was one of the chapters that when I first read 1st and 2nd Corinthians, when I was trying to, I mean really the first time I was trying to march my way through the Bible, I just got super confused. I didn't understand it at all. I've got a bunch of question marks in the margins of my Bible. I think I've told you that many times. When I started reading my Bible, I had so many questions. I just thought, well, if I stop reading every time I have a question, I'm never going to read anything. So I just started putting question marks in the margins of my Bible, hoping that some smart person would teach me about that someday, or, I don't know, I'd get it in heaven or something if I cared about that at that time. But this is one of those places where I had a lot of questions, so I want to be sure to try to explain some of the language here. So the first thing that we read about in verse 1 and verse 2 is Paul says, I wish you would bear with me in a little foolishness, but indeed you are bearing with me. Then later in verse number 4, he says, for if one comes and preaches another Jesus whom we have not preached, or you have received a different spirit that you have not received, or a different gospel you have not accepted, you bear this beautifully. So what we find in this chapter a lot of times is what's called parallel construction, or there's kind of like a similar construction either to the sentence or the words that are sort of comparing and contrasting one another. And so Paul is saying to these people, like, please bear with me a little bit more. Modern language might be like, put up with me just a little bit longer in this foolishness, the way that I'm going to talk to you right now. Just put up with me a little bit. And he's comparing and contrasting with how easily the Corinthians are putting up with or bearing beautifully things that are false, things that have led them away from what they originally were taught by Paul. And so right out of the gate, he's saying, guys, you know, as we look at the fruit of your life, as we examine the truth of your life, I am bringing you truth. And for whatever reason, it's this unbearable burden for you to live underneath the weight of these things that I'm telling you. And so it feels like a burden. And yet things that ought to feel like a burden to you, you bear beautifully. It's so easy for you to interact with these falsehoods, and it's really hard for you to interact with the truth. And it shouldn't be that way. Your conscience should just be beating in your chest when you're being led towards these paths that emphasize you in some sort of selfish ambition, pumping myself up. Your chest should be beating hard, and you should not be bearing underneath this at all. And you should be drawn towards the truth. But because they had been so wrapped up in this false path, they even couldn't identify what is true and what isn't true anymore. And so there's just something that was so opposite of about where they ended up. And Paul is talking about that. It's one of the questions that I had when I read this chapter, because I just didn't understand the language. Because he says, if you receive a different spirit, which you have not received. And I'm like, what? If you received something that you didn't receive, what does that even mean? Do you understand my confusion, or am I confusing you? Like, you don't have what you don't have, you know? Like, what? What are we talking about here? All he's talking about is the fact that Paul, he brought the gospel to them first, and he taught them these things. And then they have been led astray from what originally he taught them. And he's coming back and saying, guys, what happened? The way that I taught you how to live, the things, the patterns of your life that I showed you how to have, you don't have those things in your life anymore. What happened? You've been so led astray, and you like it. Verse number 3, he says, but I am afraid, lest as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, your minds should be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. The simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. This phrase has become for me a value statement for my life. It's become something that is like a filter that I apply when I'm examining some path that I'm considering going down, or something to engage in, or Lord, is this really you, or is this me? I use this filter as a way of helping me understand what is God, what's your path and what's not your path. And I have found that I don't exactly know what it is in me. I know it's not good, but there's something in me that is drawn towards making the things of God more complex than they really need to be. Last weekend, I talked about how I had struggled in points of leadership liking the fact that it was emphasizing me, liking the fact that it made me look good to be in this leadership position, and the Lord had to rearrange my thinking so I could recognize that being in a leadership position in front of people is exactly the same thing, or I should have the same heart as if I was doing something, serving something physically where nobody saw at all. Both of them are meant to just be helpful to other people. That's the point. And along with that theme, how I have struggled with this is wanting to bring the things of God in a very complex manner to people so that they'd be really impressed with me. That's one of the ways that I have veered astray from what I had been taught, the simplicity of what I know to be true about following God. This word simplicity is kind of a funny word. It means like straightforward. It means like no boundaries. You remember that phrase that Jesus said, if your eye is clear? The word clear is the same word as this word simplicity. It means like there's no boundaries in front of you. It's just, it's very straightforward with how to walk. And I've been thinking about how when we're in situations where it seems like there's no way forward, it seems like there's no path around us and we don't know what to do, the truth is there is a way. It is God's way, and that way works. And sometimes I even confuse myself, or I have blinders on because of my sin or because of my circumstance or whatever, and I don't look where God is asking me to look, and I don't see the simple path in front of me. It's very straightforward, and it can be done. Because sometimes when you're in a situation like that, it can feel very overwhelming. It can feel like, well, I can't do it. I don't know what to do. But God always has a path for us, and it is simple. It is not this complex thing. You do not have to understand everything about the Bible in order to follow God. Is anybody happy about that? Anybody like okay with that arrangement? Like, thank God. I don't have to pass a test in order to receive his grace, receive his forgiveness. It's really simple. And if we veer away from that, it's so dangerous, because it's very easy to mix flesh in when things are more complex. It's pretty simple, folks. Jesus died for us that we could have new life, and we get to live in that new life. Find the simple ways of following God, not these very complex ways. This reminds me of the story of Naaman, this army general or lieutenant, some big commander in the Old Testament, and he came to, was it Elisha or Elijah? I don't know. You're all murmuring. I can't understand. He went to a prophet. That's accurate, right? And he was sick. His body wasn't well, and he was sick, and he brought all these things to try to be impressive to this prophet, and the prophet said, okay, I know exactly what to do. Go dip in the River Jordan 7 times. And he just, that's so beneath me. That's so beneath what I expected to be the means by which this God, who is the Most High, would move and heal me in my life. And so he decided that he didn't want to do it. He had made a conclusion about that. And notice what it says in this verse. It says that Paul's afraid that your minds should be led astray. It's easy to come to conclusions that are not God's ways. And the simple instruction that prophet gave to Naaman was at first rejected by him. And then that little slave girl said, I mean, what do you have to lose? I mean, you're sick. So why not do the thing that was being recommended to you? Like, what do you have to lose? It's just your pride. That's it. It's just your pride. And of course, he goes and he does what the prophet said, and he got healed. There's a way of God in front of you, friend, that is simple. And I understand. I totally understand. Sometimes it's a struggle. It's a toil to figure out, Lord, what is your path? But use this. Adopt this thinking as a filter as you are evaluating what the options are in front of you. And if it doesn't pass the sniff test of that simplicity, don't do it. Wait until the simple path of the Lord is presented to you. The second word I love, the purity of devotion to Christ. What is going on in my heart? What are my true intentions? What are my true motives as I'm coming to the Lord? When you come here to service and you worship the Lord, what is the true intention of your heart? Where is your mind? Where is the pattern of your life? Are you coming to Him in that purity? And if not, and you know you need to ask for forgiveness, do that. Get pure. Get pure. It's a recurring thing. It's a revisiting thing. We all come back to the altar and say, Lord, forgive me for the impurity that I've had in my life and my heart. And it's a gift of God. It is His mercy that He points out the places in our lives that are impure. It is His mercy. So take advantage of that and repent. Get well. And the last thing is devotion to Christ. Who am I being devoted to when I'm doing this thing, whatever it is? Is this devotion to me and my career or my cause or my benefit? Am I devoted to some cause that isn't even really connected to the truth of the scriptures? Why am I doing this? For whose sake am I doing whatever it is that I'm doing? And if the answer isn't Christ, I implore you to reconsider what it is that you're doing. I think everything we do in the Lord can be described by those three things. It's simple, it's pure, and it's for the sake of Christ. Simple. I love it. One of the other ways that I have deviated from this in my life, I don't know if you've ever had this thought, like really genuinely wanting someone to come to the knowledge of the truth of God. Like maybe they're a friend of yours that doesn't believe in God, or maybe they do believe in the Lord, but they're having a hard time living in the freedom or the purity of what God would want for them. And I have felt the temptation to go beyond what I know the Lord has asked me to share with them, or to like emphasize certain parts of the gospel and like de-emphasize other parts of the gospel. You know what I'm talking about? That pesky sin thing. Let's just talk about how God wants to comfort you, okay? Maybe that will draw them in. And in an attempt, I mean, you know, some part of this is just a pure desire that I had. I wanted to appeal to people. I wanted it to be attractive to them. But I know in the depth of my heart that was a manipulation. I allowed an impure stream into what should have been a straightforward message of the gospel. And we have to be honest with people. We have to be upfront with them. That the reason why Jesus came is because we have sinned. You have done wrong. a lot of it. But Jesus came to forgive us for that. And if we don't know how to explain that, if we don't know how to present that in a very simple, straightforward manner, friends, it won't actually appeal to the real part of people's hearts that want to be right with their Heavenly Father. We all want to be reconciled to God deep down inside of us. And so we ought to be appealing to those things, not the comfort of their flesh. That is not doing them any favors. So, of course, I don't want to beat people over the head with my Bible or yell and scream at them and fire and brimstone them or something like that. But at the same time, I don't want to lead them astray. I don't want to be dishonest about what the premise of this whole thing is, that we are wicked and God has forgiven us. That's why we're here. That's why we're here. Simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. So now the passage transitions here in verse number 5. Where Paul is, you know, he's comparing and contrasting, saying, you know, the things I'm telling you, it's very hard for you to accept, apparently, and the things that are not true are very easy for you to accept. And so now he's going to compare and contrast his apostleship with the apostleship of these false apostles. And he says, I consider myself not in the least inferior to the most eminent apostles. But even if I am unskilled in speech, yet I am not so in knowledge. Remember that these pseudo-apostles were emphasizing things like looking really impressive with the things that you say and your presence. And that was one of the main criticisms of Paul, that his presence was unimpressive and his speech contemptible, it says in the previous chapter. That these fake apostles were just totally slandering the ministry of Paul and saying, like, look at how he is when he's in your presence. It's totally nothing to write home about. I mean, this is, like, pathetic, okay? He doesn't even bring fog machines with him. I mean, what kind of ministry is there without fog machines? What do you think it's going to be like in heaven? Fog machines everywhere. And so Paul's like, okay, fine. Even if I am unskilled in speech, even if I grant that to you, and let's say we're on the same page, and I'm not as skilled of a speaker as these other people. I'm telling you that I am not that same way in knowledge, and that he's made this evident to you in all things. You see, because this path of, like, looking really important, as you might imagine, involves how you look, not the substance of what is contained in your life. And again, what we talked about last week is how just saying things is totally different than doing things that are helpful. And that's what we want to emphasize. Verse number 7, he said, did I commit a sin in humbling myself that you might be exalted because I preached the gospel of God to you without charge? Okay, I was totally confused by this. I'm like, what? Without charge? Because I was thinking like how somebody might charge you with a challenge or something, or, you know, admonish you with a charge. But it's literally talking about money. In fact, I have circled that word and drew an arrow and written the word money to remind myself that's what he's talking about. So, and this is just, it's almost crazy for me to explain it, that, like, this was a deep criticism of Paul's. But basically, he was criticized because he didn't charge them money for coming and ministering to them. And these other people, I assume, were charging money themselves. And the logic goes, well, how much can it be worth if it's free? Right? Like a professor of mine once told me, nothing in life is free. Which is hilarious because I was on a college campus, and I had just visited a booth with free pizza as long as you sign up for a credit card. And I had the stench of what I realized was not free pizza still in my mouth as I was listening to this professor say, nothing's free in life. There's always a string attached to it. And I thought, oh boy, I've got to go cancel that right after class. It was like perfect. Yeah. You know, I mean, if you go to a store, you go to a discount store and you buy something that is cheaper, you expect that the quality is as much as you paid for it, right? Well, they're kind of applying that same sort of logic here, that, like, I mean, how good can it be if he's not even charging you anything for it? My goodness. But what breaks my heart is that why Paul was doing that was to bless them. And they had totally manipulated and misunderstood the reason why Paul was doing these things. And so they were criticizing him for being unimpressive, not being loud and boisterous, not charging them money when he came, and thinking this is just some, you know, pathetic mouse of a man, when in fact that is the picture of true spiritual authority. It's the meekness that I think we see in the character of Jesus. I mean, have you ever thought about the self-control that Jesus had to exhibit? As these puny humans were ridiculing him and beating him, saying all these untrue things about him. And he just stood there with self-control and took it all. And here we see Paul, I think, adopting that same sort of character, that the very people that he is trying to love, I mean, doesn't that sound like Jesus? Jesus, the very people he came to die for are the people who are putting him to death. And here's Paul, the very people that he is trying to love, he's trying to minister to, are criticizing him for loving them, not realizing that what he was doing was loving them. But Paul had the presence of mind, and I think the emotional and spiritual maturity to not only withstand all of that, but then he makes a statement later on. He's like, and I'm going to continue to do this. I know what you're saying about me. I know how you're talking about this decision that I've made to live my life in this way, where I'm just trying not to be a burden to you financially or otherwise. And I'm going to continue to do that, even though apparently this godly thing that I'm doing is hurting my reputation among you. But this is what I'm about. I'm going to humble myself continually so that you wouldn't have to be burdened. I mean, the heart of Paul coming out in all this is commendable. This is attractive to me. Like, I want my life to be like that, which is interesting because Paul's describing a very difficult life circumstance. So, hang on, how do I explain this? It's the very opposite of what I was tempted to do when I didn't want to talk about sin so much with people and I wanted to talk just about the comfort of God. And here I am being attracted to discomfort myself. So that should teach me something about what is genuinely attractive to people's spirits inside of them as we talk about what it really is like to follow God. Oh, sure, it's difficult. And oh, sure, people are not going to like you because you are walking in the integrity of what God has asked you to do. But it is so right. It's how God has asked us to live. And you can do it. It is simple. So Paul was bankrolled by someone else, and he said, I robbed other churches. He doesn't actually mean like he, you know, snuck in at night and took out of the offering basket. He didn't sit in the last row, like, perfect, the last offering basket, and did that. But, you know, God provided for him from some other means so that he could go and minister to these places. I mean, think about the places Paul was able to go to because he didn't require that they took care of his food and lodging and the money that he needed just to live. I mean, think about how enabling that was. So this isn't a statement against somebody taking wages from church. This is a statement of how we want to posture our hearts, that we want to come underneath people and serve them so that we're not a burden to them, even as we are giving them truth. And then later on, he really, I think, has an emotional, vulnerable moment. In verse number 10, he says, the truth of Christ is in me. This boasting of mine will not be stopped in the regions of Achaia. I think one of the other accusations that people were making against Paul, that he was so boastful. And he's like, you got to be kidding me. Not charging you money is my boast? Okay, all right, well, I guess this boasting is going to continue in all these regions because I'm not going to start charging people money for this. That's not what I'm about. Verse 11, why? Why am I doing this? Because I do not love you? God knows that I do. But what I am doing, I will continue to do, that I may cut off opportunity from those who desire an opportunity to be regarded just as we are in the matter about which they are boasting. Here we learn, I think, what is at the root of what these false apostles were so, they just were so fixated on Paul, and they couldn't just do their own ministry. I mean, if they had a different ministry philosophy, fine, great, hallelujah, we're the body of Christ, we look different, fine. But what is the preoccupation with slandering Paul's ministry? Like, why did they have to do that? Well, I think it's because they were jealous. They wanted to be regarded with the same kind of authority and impressiveness that Paul actually has. And they did that by tearing him down. One of the biblical connection points that we have about jealousy that can truly just start out as a sin. It is a sin. I mean, it's one of the Ten Commandments, for crying out loud. It doesn't get more sinful than that. It is a sin, but it can also be taken advantage of by the enemy. And that's what we learn later in the later verses, that Paul very clearly says that they are false apostles, deceitful workers, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. Verse 15, therefore it's not surprising if his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness. There's something sinister about how these evil demonic forces so want to take advantage of where there is any jealousy. Because jealousy often is connected to hatred, and that hatred can go even so far as a desire to want to cut off or even to kill. I was thinking about Saul and how jealous he was, just so consumed with jealousy and hatred of David, as David was rising in his importance and his impressiveness to the other people. And David's just doing his thing. You know, he's just following the Lord and doing what God has asked him to do. And then Saul just jealously was looking on at what he knew that he had lost, really, by looking at David's life. And that brought him to a place where he actually physically wanted to kill David. But friend, do you know that even if you're not brought to a place where physically are tempted to do something like that, that in your heart you can devise murder, you can devise hatred and cutting off of someone just because of jealousy? So be careful about that. Understand that it's just not wise to look at the ministry of another and desire it. That's why you want to understand, Lord, what are you asking me to do? What is the simple thing you're putting in front of me? And I don't want to be so concerned about what you're putting in front of somebody else or whoever else and how big their small group is or how many times they've been asked to be on council or whatever it is. I just want to be concerned about what's going on with me, Lord, because it's your devotion to Christ, not their devotion to Christ. It's yours. So take it, own it, find it, follow him. Last thing here, I just want to mention, as I said, that I believe that, well, let me say it this way. The Bible teaches that Satan wants to kill, to steal, and to destroy. So if in my sin, a jealous rage, I want to kill something of the work of God or even someone in the Lord, you know, I'm talking about like even just in my heart that I just want to cut off that person, that is in line with the desires of the enemy. And that's why I think it's so easy for them to kind of mix together, and there can be such a demonic element of a spirit of jealousy that goes above and beyond even just a sin of jealousy. But all of this, we're freed from all of this as we keep our eyes on the Lord and as we are devoting ourselves to simply in the purity of our hearts following him, celebrating what God is doing through and in other people, and not worrying about whether you are responsible for those things or you are given credit for those things. But I just want to keep my head down and be helpful to the people around me. That is my ambition in the Lord. Let's pray. Well, Father, I thank you that you have taken these incredible spiritual principles that I believe are genuinely complex, and you have translated them into a way that even we can understand. You have made your message so simple, so straightforward for us in our lives. And not just the incredible gospel of Jesus Christ coming to the earth, dying for my sin, and then rising again so that I could live just as he does. Not just that, but even the instruction for my life today as a follower of Jesus, that you make the instruction of how to do that also straightforward and simple. Thank you, Lord. You did not have to do it that way. Thank you for coming down to my level so that I could understand. And Lord, I pray that we all would learn how to do that in our own lives. That we might even be like means of translation of your word to another person, to their heart, to their lives, that we could be servants of your work in them, that we could be helpful to clarify what it is that you are asking them to do. So Lord, may we become a community that has ears to hear your word from reading the Bible, but also from hearing the testimony and the counsel of the people around us. And also, would you alert us, Lord, to opportunities where we can share what we know to help another in their walk with you. Thank you, Lord, for your great power. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen.